Adam Savage here in my cave with Tested's end of the year wrap-up of our favorite things, the U edition. I've already covered my favorite things this year, and they are a hodgepodge of all sorts of different objects and things that I loved. They're not always the easiest to obtain or assemble, but we thought it would be reasonable this year to do a compendium of your favorite things from our channel. So to begin with, I'm gonna go over some of your favorite tooltips that we covered. The first one is this beautiful endoscope made by Nidage, I believe is how it might be pronounced. You guys ordered so many of these, they immediately went out of stock and their price went up. We'll include a link to this, plus a link to some others that are very similar. What you should know is that when a technology like this shows up and you see like five different brands all selling what look like slightly different versions, those are all very likely made in the same exact factory using the same exact electronics. And that factory is selling outer covers to different companies. And they're also adding different features if they want them, and that's reasonable within the price point. But just because the exact one we mentioned sold out doesn't mean that you can't get the one that will work for you. I love this endoscope because it's got a skinnier end, just a hair's breadth under 250 thousandths or a quarter of an inch in diameter. It's got its own built-in light. The app is better than any other endoscope app I have yet used because it allows you to actually adjust the rotation of the image on the app itself. That's massive. And man, sometimes only a tiny little camera is going to show you where the problem is. And especially if you're a homeowner, this is a great way to troubleshoot some hard to reach areas in your house. Yeah. I love extending my eyes. I never tire of the view you get when you can put a camera where you didn't normally, weren't able to do it. No, stop thinking that gross stuff. I'm not talking about jamming it in your nose or wherever. Okay, the next item on my list, I think it might be the least expensive item I covered all year, but it is my favorite pair of safety goggles. As a thick glasses wearer, safety goggles are a particular hell for me and all other glasses wearers because they rattle along, they don't give you a lot of protection. Well, I can't remember when DeWalt first came out with these, but I do remember I was like, oh, dude. Because I think we bought them on Mythbusters, and then as soon as I saw them, I bought three or four pairs for myself. They're super lightweight. They are resistant to fogging, and they have a rubber gasket which covers every bit. You could not be safer wearing these. They are my favorite safety goggles, and there are several... There are a couple of different models. I still haven't figured out the difference between them, but this is their least expensive model and it's fantastic. I know I get a lot of complaints from regular Tested viewers that I do not wear my safety equipment enough, and mea culpa. Yes, I'm trying, Ringo. I'm trying to use my safety equipment every time. I know I'm here to set an example as well as do my work. I get you. I hear all the things that you're saying. I see the comments. These are my favorite safety goggles. The third item on my list is one that changed my life when I first learned about it in 1993. Yeah, this is a pair of automatic wire strippers. And until these existed, hold on just a second. I want to grab something and show you. Let us say you have a wire that is sticking out of a very, very small hole, and you've got to strip the end of that wire, okay? So this is the wire sticking out of your device and you got to strip it so you can solder a lead to it. Well, forever, this is effectively what you would use. A pair of sharpened blades whose hole corresponded to the gauge of the wire you were using, and you pull on it and it strips the wire, which is great when you can hold the wire in your hand. But if you can't, well, these are a great way to yank wire or break electronics inside your device. I have run into more trouble using these over the years. The automatic wire stripper takes care of that problem because you don't need to use your own arm to separate the wire from its shielding. The cutters do that for you. They have this exterior set of grippers out here at the front that grab the wire while an internal pair of blades right there pulls the housing off that wire. Dude. Yeah. Now, when I first learned about these in the early 90s, they were not cheap. I think the cheapest pair you could find was well over $100. Now you can buy these for about 15, 20 bucks, and we'll include a link below. Everyone who ever needs to work with wire should have one of these in their kit. There are a lot of different form factors. This happens to be my favorite. And if you're looking for a prosumer, a level up, I personally would go with the Greenlee brand, G-R-E-E-N-L-E-E. They make a lot of different electrical hardware for electricians and other folks to use, and they make great stuff that won't break the bank. Automatic wire strippers, they're your friend. When it comes to one-day builds, you also had three favorites. The first of them being my portable soldering station. This one utilizes this beautiful USB-powered soldering iron, which is my new favorite thing. I power it off of a DeWalt battery that I can stick in here at the bottom, and that also adds some heavy, it lowers the center of gravity, so this is less tippy. I have also added a feature to this since the one-day build. I've added this plywood hook, so this now sits on the side of my electronics cart, like so. Much easier to reach out and grab. Again, I use this thing on an almost daily basis, and having it take up so little of my benchtop space, it's still one of my favorite new tools here in the shop. The second build you guys loved, well, this is also one that I loved tremendously, and it is my Hellboy Samaritan build. This summer sucked even worse than the rest of this year, and I needed to sink my teeth into a big fat build and decided to replicate Hellboy's famous sidearm, the Samaritan, completely out of aluminum. When I embarked upon this, I did not know if I would be able to complete it. It is way out at the bleeding edge of my skills as a machinist. I have long said that my skill on the mill is as an aesthetic machinist. I can make stuff look great, but as far as making it actually work, that's harder for me. And with something like this, where every aspect of it is both aesthetic and mechanical, I was tested, as it were. But it has a laser in the front sight that's activated by half pulling the trigger. It has a hammer that you can pull back, a trigger that you can pull. It also cracks apart like the original, and with magnets, I got a beautiful click on the cylinder spinning. I also made a whole bunch of bullets, and as you can see, this beautiful box for it. It is an ongoing project. It still needs its barrel rifled. It still needs to be chemically blackened, both of which will be future one-day builds. But for right now, you and I agree this is one of the best things I built this year. The third one-day build that you loved is one I must say I was not even positive I wanted to edit it after I'd shot it. And that is my giant nut and bolt. This is almost the precursor to the Samaritan. Well, it is actually the spiritual precursor to the Samaritan build. I looked up at the beginning of COVID and realized I was spending much more time on my machine tools than normal. And I thought, you know, I've cut threads before on the lathe, but I've never cut internal and external threads that had to marry to each other. I wonder what that's like. So I actually made a small nut and bolt here on one weekend, and it gave me so much confidence in my machining skills that I decided to make a giant nut and bolt out of brass and screwed it up repeatedly on camera, doing terrible crimes to my lathe while it was spinning. I had this thing turning out, breaking off, this thing peeling out of my jaws. It harmed the scroll of my three-jaw chuck. Yeah, I had to take it all apart and file a little bit to get rid of some of the munging. And when I was finished, I did not feel great about myself. I don't like screwing up. I don't like making obvious mistakes, and I definitely don't like doing them on camera, despite the fact that that's a large part of what I've done on Tested, is make mistakes on camera. I mean, I joke that my brand is that I paint myself into a corner and film myself getting out. But the reality is, sometimes getting out feels treacherous and vulnerable. And I screwed this up enough on camera that I wasn't sure I wanted to share it. And then I decided, of course, that I did want to share it. And your guys' response to this video, your appreciation of my willingness to talk about the difficult and dark places our brains can go when we make stuff and it doesn't always go according to plan, made it all worthwhile. I really appreciate, like, there's a feedback loop here. It's not just, I'm not just making content that you take in. I'm also reading what you're talking about it, and it's informing the way in which I move forward. Our whole team, this is a conversation, and that conversation between the makers and the watchers, yeah, it's a terrible, simplistic delineation, but that's culture. That's culture. We're building our own little culture here on Tested, and talking about things that I don't often see getting talked about on YouTube or online. And I really appreciate how open the audience is for that kind of discussion, because none of us spends all of our time in a happy place. None of us. Nobody does. Nobody. If you know someone that does, I guarantee you they're, yeah, nobody escapes. Nobody escapes. And the more we normalize those dark places our brains can go, the better off we will all be to take care of each other. And frankly, taking care of each other is our main job as humans. Those are the three favorite one-day builds. Of course, my builds weren't the only builds we cover here on Tested. I also did a lot of show and tell of some amazing creations by makers from all over the world. And first up on those are Gary Fay's incredible demon fingers. I don't know what these things are. If it's fun to watch me wear these, I got to tell you, it's just as much fun to actually wear them. Gary custom made these to measurements of my fingers, and mechanically, they're masterpieces. I plan to use these in a creepy costume at some point in the very near future. Gary, my hat is off to you. Ooh. Oh, wow. I could really, yeah, there we go. I could put a real booger finder on the end of that. Now, second up of your favorite builds that I covered of other people is, come on, let's see if I can pick it up. There we go. Ben Eadie's beautiful, lightweight foam chainmail. This feels like a sea change for cosplaying. Ben has come up with a way of making chainmail that is so surpassingly simple, I'm a little mad that no one's thought about it before. But he sells this on his website. We will include links in the comments below. I love it when an invention like this shows up. And the number of possibilities that this opens up for cosplayers is really just, there's no limit to this. He's using circles. There's no reason you have to use circles. This can do all sorts of things to add tremendous value to cosplay in general. The last item on your list of favorite things that we showcased this year on Tested is also one of my all-time favorite things we have ever and continue to cover on Tested. And he's curled up at the foot of my workbench right now. Ladies and gentlemen, say hi to Spot. Yes, wait, wake up there. There we go, hi. Here's the thing that I love about the fact that you guys love Spot, because a lot of people look at this and it kind of creeps them out. And I understand that intellectually, but I do not understand it viscerally, because when I look at this thing, I see a magnificent piece of engineering that feels like the future. And it is all of those things and so much more. And I know we started off 2020 with a bunch of Spot videos and you haven't seen any in a while, and it's because a lot of the plans that I had for Spot were all collaborations. And if there's one thing that 2020 did, was it made collaborating with other human beings much harder because of the lockdown. However, we're getting up and running again with this guy because we still have a whole bunch of plans. And my goal is for the whole world to see what I see when I look at this, which is a beautiful, magnificent piece of future engineering right now, today. Let's dance. What do you think, Spot? Should we wrap this up? I know, I don't want to go either, but there you have it. That is the last of our tested favorite things this year. And I would be completely remiss if I did not say that what made 2020 really bearable in so many ways for us is actually you. Our loyal viewers, our new viewers, our old viewers who have come back. We love telling stories on this channel about making and about enthusiasm, about creativity and about community. And we love telling those stories to you. And we love hearing your stories back in return. You truly have made this difficult year far more magical than it had any right to be for us. And we deeply appreciate it. Happy holidays. Happy New Year. Peace out. Here's to 2021. And we love you guys. All right. Shall we go for a walk? No? You just want to go to sleep? All right. Good night, buddy. Thank you so much for watching that video. If you'd like to further support us on Tested, there are many ways you can do so. One is through paid membership, and there are several tiers of that, each with their own set of unique bonuses. You can follow the links below for that, or you can go to our merch store where we are always coming up with brand new products. In honor of the holidays, we've got our Tested Ugly sweater in both black and we have a white one. We have some brand new patches. And this is a particular type that I made a joke about one day, and now it's a reality. You know about merit badges. When you're a Cub Scout or a Boy Scout, you get a merit badge for achieving something. Well, Tested now has demerit badges for when you screw something up, because that's just as important in learning as getting something right. So this is the badge for when you measure something once and have to cut it twice. This is the badge for when you accidentally hook up your electronics wrong and you release the mysterious blue smoke that powers them and they no longer work. And this one here is for when you get your finger caught in a lathe and it almost gets torn off. That might be quite me specific. I hope that never happens to you. These are all designed by Tested's own Jen Schachter, and they are not the only patches we're gonna release. In fact, these are just the beginning. If you have ideas for demerit badges that we should release, we'd love to hear them. We also still have our regular complement of posters, and they're all back in stock, including my hand-drawn toolboxes. I love seeing pictures you guys send us of these hanging in your makerspaces and your offices, your man caves, and your sheds around the world. Get to the store, follow the links below, and hey, some of these might make great Christmas presents for the makers in your life. Thanks, you guys. Happy holidays.